So then.
So, every time I have to change something in code that I didn't write, I really, really, really wish the guy who wrote it would have written more tests about it. Just to be a little bit on the safe side that I don't break something I didn't want to break. Unfortunately, that other guy is typically me 6 months ago. And I always have this temptation to do the testing later because, hey, I know what I'm doing and I just have to get it working now and I can always polish it later, and then later never happens. So it always haunts me back then. I think that's something in the psychology of us humans. If there's something we don't like, then we push it aside, we procrastinate, we do something more interesting like looking for cat videos in the internet. But there's also another side to it. If we have to do an activity that we don't like, but we have nice tools that we like to use, then we can get around. So for example, if you have to write this stupid report back in school and you hated it, but you had a nice pen that you really liked, a nice book to write in, then all of a sudden the activity itself becomes more tolerable. So in this talk, I would like to show you a tool that hopefully makes writing tests much more tolerable to you, so that you can actually find some fun in writing testing. Introducing Spock. Spock is a test framework and a domain-specific language for the Java Virtual Machine that comes with support for data-driven testing and has strong built-in mocking capabilities. So much for the high-level description. My name is Mafi Werner. Mark Philip for long, but only my mother's using that. Mafi is the call sign forever since my friends decided that yelling, "Mark Philip, there's the ball," on the football field is way too long. I'm working for CodeCentric in Germany, out of the Stuttgart office. I'm in the IT business now for more than 20 years, actually. And the last 1.5, 2 years, I had a lot of testing work, which inspired this little talk here. Okay, first things first. If I want to use Spock, and I'm a Groovy developer because this is GradeConf, so I assume all of you are Groovy developers, then I of course have to add something to my Gradle configuration. And that's pretty simple. All I need is this one line here, which is telling me test compile, blah, 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 and then I have all the classes available in my environment. Straightforward. So this one here. And there's also Maven version. If you prefer Maven, Google it up, because the XML is something like this, just because Maven. Then put it here. And if I have done that, then I can actually get started and write my first simple test. So what I have to do? First, of course, import the classes. Do, yeah, big surprise. Then I have to create a class that extends the specification interface. Okay, also pretty straightforward and clear. Now I have a test specification for using the Spock. And now I can write my actual tests, which are methods inside the specification. Here we get the first interesting stuff. If you look at that method name here, ooh, what's that? In Spock, I can actually create method names as real strings. I can use whitespace, I can use whatever I need to make them nice and readable. And since those will also be used in the output of your unit test frame environment like IntelliJ or something like that, it means that the whole stuff becomes much more readable and easier to understand than just camel casing or underscoring or whatever do you typically use when you are forced to do it in method names. Return type of the method is void. If you look at Spock documentations, you will see a lot of defs around there as well. Choose whatever you prefer. I'm from the school that say, if I know the type of something, I write it down, so you prefer to use void. Using def works as well. It just doesn't return anything anyway. So now the thing that makes this whole thing a Spock test is actually this little expect here, which is the first of multiple keywords that are coming in the domain-specific language. Expect means that after the keyword, I expect all lines to be true. So this 1 plus 2 equals to 3 is actually an assertion. I don't need to write any assert in front of it or wrap it in functions or whatever. Just that's all done automatically by Spock. Just by saying expect. All lines below that either have to be from the void return type, in which case they are ignored from an assertion point of view, or they will be checked by GroovyTruth. And since GroovyTruth is pretty all-encompassing, you can put a lot in here to get your tests. So, pretty straightforward. Well, most of the time it will be a little bit longer. And Spock is taking a strong cue from what's called the behavioral-driven design, BDD, which is a strategy to write your tests in a way that non-IT personnel can actually understand them. If you worked with Cucumber or Gherkin before, that's also that particular syntax. What you will see here is this given-when-then structure most of the time. Given some preconditions, then I do a manipulation, and when I do a manipulation, then I expect certain results to be true. Straightforward. So given preconditions, when manipulation, then results. In the then block, as in the expect block, assertions are implicit, so I don't have to write them down here. The other thing you see here, that I can actually give comments as strings after the keywords, after the DSL keywords. Of course, I could use a regular comment to achieve almost the same, except for two things. First is, from a readability point of view, I can now use the given when then in my narrative, which makes it, again, easier to read. And then there are reporting tools available that will extract those blocks out of your tests to show what you have been testing, actually, and they take in those strings, so it's documentation at the end of the day for reporting purposes. And if you happen to have one of those rare POs that actually understand Gherkin and write your specifications in Gherkin, there's also the way around that you take the Gherkin specification and compile it into a skeleton test, in which case you will get the given when then blocks out of the Gherkin specification, and then you can just write in the code. But that requires a PO that's willing to go through that time kind of work, and unfortunately they are rare, but they exist. Given is actually an alias to setup. So if you prefer to write setup instead of given, you can do that. Nothing changes otherwise. There's another block called cleanup, which you can put at the end if you have something to, well, clean up. So if you allocated some resources at the beginning that you need to get rid of again because they're not automatically cleaned up, then the cleanup block will take care of that at the end of the actual test. Cleanup also works if I wrote given in the beginning, but there is no nice alias there otherwise. Okay, so far so good. Sometimes tests fail. I mean, that's why we are testing. And if you're doing test-driven development, then you know that you always should make the test fail before you start working on it. Otherwise, you don't know whether your test is actually testing what it's supposed to test. So, since we are using Groovy, we have the Groovy comparisons available, and I can do something like compare actually lists immediately without much boilerplate. Now this test fails for obvious reasons, and if I do that, I get an assert output that looks like this. If you have used the asserts in Groovy before, this might look familiar, because the power asserts have been lifted from Spock to Groovy itself a while ago, just because it's so useful. So no need to write print line statements to see what's going on or fire up the debugger. The power assert will show you directly what actually happened. So this is false because that's the value left, value right. You can feed it in with more complicated structures as well. The way it prints it is actually pretty nice. At one point it gets convoluted if you try to compare 100 element arrays or something like that. But most of the time it's actually pretty readable and will help you debug the stuff really quickly. So, to wake you up a little bit, what do you think? Is this test red or green? Anybody? And Benny, you are not qualified because you know the answer. Nobody? Come on. Red, green, yellow, pink. Red? Why? Red because I'm not actually modifying the map. Okay, let's see. It's green. Okay, what's happening here? First, I'm checking, I have a for loop here. Return value of a for loop is void. What's happening inside the for loop, unfortunately, is not automatically checked by the expect keyword. My map width is a closure. A closure, the return value of a closure is the last statement of the closure, which happens to be true, which makes the whole thing true as well. So, closures and Spock testing handle with care. But we can do better than that. First thing, Spock actually has its own version of the width. Well, first thing you can do, you can put asserts explicitly on it. So if you have to have a closure, or same thing, by the way, if you're calling out an external function for the verification, you have to write the assert keyword in front of it. Okay, works, but ugly. Then for the width, there's actually a Spock function variant of the width statement. I mean, what width is doing, it is taking my variable and putting the delegate into a closure so that I can access the members directly. The Spock version is doing the same, but it automatically injects the assertion statements again. So using the Spock width instead of the Groovy width, auto asserts are working again. That's actually a construct that you might use a lot if you want to test structures and things like that. Now with the for loop, it actually makes sense to replace that with the function operators that maps and lists have built in. So instead of using a for loop, I just go over all values, and for every value, evaluate that it's one. And in that case, I will actually get now a red test, and I see that this went wrong. Still kind of ugly, but it works at least. I mean, in here, I now have to go through my array myself and say, okay, first one probably worked. Say, the second one was not working. Okay. There's a better way to do that. I'll show you in a couple of minutes. But at least for now, that's how we can get around it if we have to. Testing exceptions, of course, is also available. So if I have a method that throws an exception, what I have to do is I have to write this thrown in here to catch it. This requires a when-then block. You cannot do it with an expect block. You have to separate it. If you want to, you can catch the exception into a variable that you can use for further verifications. And introducing and. And is another documentation keyword. And means I have something else. It has the same semantics as the keyword before. So in this case, it's a then block. But sometimes I have multiple things that are logically maybe a little bit separated, so I can again use it for documentation purposes. Okay, next quiz. That's a specification with two tests which are executed in, one after the other. Actually, for now we can assume that the one on the left is executed before the one on the right. What do you think? Well, if I run the whole specification, is it red or green? Why it's red? That's exactly right. This one is actually red. So, what Spock is doing, if you have members like this, member fields, they will be reset before every execution of a method, automatically. So, this counter will be one for both runs, and as it should. Isolation is working. Those will be reset all the time. If you don't want that, then you have... come on. Yeah, that. Wait a bit. Where have you stopped? Here. If you don't want that, then you have to write shared in front of it. Annotate it with shared. Shared elevates it to the specification level, and now all manipulations will actually be persisted on that variable. By the way, you should avoid using class fields in Spock specifications except for constants, because the whole Spock logic can't really deal with them otherwise. So shared is your Spock variant of having a class field. Now, what we just have seen is an example of test leakage, meaning one test doing something which affects the other test, which is bad mojo anyway. What you can do against that is have some kind of a guard at the beginning that protects your variables. For example, you could just set, I expect that my counter is one. And this, to illustrate, actually means I can have expect when then in the same test. I can actually have as many when then blocks and expect blocks in the test as I want to. So I have something more complicated. I can create a long one where I go through different conditions, different checks, then go for the next stage. Matter of style and readability. Don't write your tests too long, but sometimes it's required, blah, blah, blah. It's possible at least. And I think the guard example is pretty good. I mean, for this one, it's trivial, but if you think of a database where you want to make sure that the tables have been cleaned before your test is running, and sometimes it's just the cleanup is not working, then such a guard can save you a lot in debugging time. Another nice thing that Spock has is the old keyword or function here. Old remembers the value of a variable before the modification was made. Before the when. So I can check if the old value plus one is actually my new value. Again, trivial example, but if you think of something like a huge object, it can be quite helpful to have them easily comparable and makes it readable again. I mean, under the covers, all it does is takes your old variable, copies into another one, and then replaces that again. But readability is just easier by using the old. So, if you have more than one test in your specification, in a lot of cases you have certain common setups that have to happen. In Spock, they are called setup spec, setup, cleanup, and cleanup spec. They're doing exactly what the names imply. So, meaning setup spec is run once at the beginning of the specification, setup is run before every test, and the cleanup vice versa. So, if you have fields to initialize, you can do it directly, as we saw before. But if you have something more complicated to do, like open the database connection or something, then the setup method can be used to do it over and over again, as expected. In Spock, you can also use inheritance for your specifications. So you can have a parent specification and then have multiple child specifications, which makes sense in case you have certain setup that is valid for multiple test suites, actually, and you want to separate again for logic. Because really there is no law in existence that for one class you can only have one test class. Like there's no law in existence that for one method you can only have one test method. Actually, you should have more tests than classes typically, at least if you're well testing. And for organizing purposes, this is helpful. And of course, the execution order is as I would expect it. First the setups from the parent class, then the setups from the child class, and the cleanups in the opposite order. Speaking of cleanup, there's also a nice annotation called auto cleanup that you can use to flag your fields. If a field is flagged as auto cleanup, then the close method will automatically be called on it after every run of a test. So for, again, database stuff, resources, there's just one thing less I have to worry about if I flag it like this, because all of the calls will happen automatically. Unfortunately, not those cleanup methods are not always called close. No problem. I can also give a parameter to my auto cleanup annotation that tells it, hey, by the way, for that field, use this method after run, each run. And if I flag the whole thing as shared, then it's not done after every run, but after the whole specification. So it is lifted to the specification level again. Okay, so far so good. Where? Spock is strong in data-driven testing. In many cases, you have a test that you are repeating over and over again, just with different sets of data, which can become very verbatim if you have to copy it over and over again. In Spock, we have the where block, the where keyword, where I can specify a data pipe. And for every element in the data pipe, the whole test is now executed once, including setup, including cleanup, and so on. So this little code here will execute 4 tests for me. In the report, I will only see 1 line, so to keep it readable and short, but repetition has happened automatically. If you want to, you can write the name of the pipe as a parameter on your test. However, this, the whole thing being groovy, and groovy meaning the less I type, the better, you can also leave it off. Spock will automatically deduct it from the where field alone. The only reason to write it is, well, documentation, if you forget, or if you have an IDE that does not understand Spock well enough, then this can help you a lot with IDE auto-completion and stuff like that. IntelliJ doesn't need it, though. So most examples you find in the literature, again, don't use it because too much typing. And remember when I said loops are an N-type pattern? This is how to do them correctly. So the whole thing we did with the for loop before in the other example can be much easier accomplished with this setup. I also can have more than one data pipe in the same test. The only thing I have to watch out for is that all pipes have the same number of elements. And so for each iteration of the where clause, one element will be taken from each pipe and the test will be executed. And for the pipe itself, I can take everything that Groovy can iterate over, which is a lot. I can have a function that returns me some iterable array or something like that. Arrays, whatever. Most of the time, though, the table is the preferred way to do it. In this notation, every row represents one iteration of the test, taking the values for the variables according to the columns. If you have to write something like this, don't worry about the formatting. At least in IntelliJ, the auto format will make the table nice and shiny. Helps a lot. And inside the table, I can also have function calls. I can make references to shared variables and static fields. So I can have as many columns as I need, as many rows as I need. So this is really a nice way to build up a huge data-driven test that still stays pretty well handleable. Only problem I can get, of course, if I have something with 100 rows here, then if something fails and my test gets read, now which one? Yeah, the power assert will show me, of course, but happy searching. Well, the solution to that is called unroll. Unroll is an annotation on the method that tells it, please give me 1 line for each execution in my unit test. So, of course, now my unit test output will be flooded, but at least I can see every execution. And I can use my variables from the where block in my string here, which gives me an output like this. So all of a sudden, I know exactly which iteration actually failed. I can even go a little bit further than that. So see this assignment I'm doing here? Assignments will be executed for every iteration. and they can reference all variables defined above. So I can actually introduce some string or whatever that helps me finding out what's going on. And if I need to just make it beautiful, for example, I have a test that is sometimes using string output, and sometimes I need an S and something I don't need an S for grammatical reasons, I could build that in here if I want to, just to make it look nice. So assignments executed every run, and in the unroll I see where I am actually. You can even go so far now that you have the where block that you completely separate logic and test data by moving all of the test data always into the where block. So the above the test itself would only be logic, and all variable test data go to where, and then you know what to look for when you have to modify the test data. Another thing that Spock comes with is the interaction-based testing, or mocking. So what is mocking? Mocking means I have some collaborator, some service, outside service or something, and I want to make sure that my code is calling that code in the correct way. In mocking itself, I don't care so much about what comes back. I'm interested about what I give to the external service. The other way around would be called stubbing. In stubbing, I'm not so interested in what I do send to the service, but what's come back from the service to me, to make sure I get values under control. Sometimes it's mixed, but if you really write small tests that test one particular functionality, then it's typically one or the other. So, if I have to write a mock, I start with some interface, like my data interface here that has one method in it. And my function under test is double data, and what's it does? It returns me twice the value of retrieve. Straightforward. Now, this data thing is something highly complicated, and it's an interface actually, so I don't have an object for it. Well, no problem. All I have to do is say, hey, given a variable that's a mock of that interface. Ta-da, I'm done. I now have a legal object of implementing the data interface that I can work with. Now I can say, okay, I want to call double data with keystring as my string, and my test should guarantee that my data retrieve is called once. Again, I don't care about the return values at this time, I just care about my interaction with the service. Call me once, and nothing else. The underscore here is a wildcard saying I don't care about the parameter actually. So this test is green because retrieve is called exactly once. A couple of more things I can specify here. I can have zero, means nothing. I can have ranges if I'm not exactly sure because it's kind of random. At least, and so on, any number of times. A couple of things are possible here in my syntax. So this way I can make sure my code is calling my outside service as expected. Now, sometimes I don't have the luxury of having an interface available. Sometimes I have to mock a class directly. Well, okay, I have a class, I mock the class. Oh, by the way, as you can see here, instead of writing the class in the parentheses, as I did before, I can also just specify it like this, just an alternative syntax that will also give you the mock. Now, otherwise, it looks like the last one. I execute it, I get an error. What does it say? It basically is saying I cannot mock a class directly, I need some code generation library, blah, blah, blah. Okay, easy enough. I have to do a little modification to my Gradle configuration to pull in the library, and ta-da, now it works. The only thing I cannot mock are final classes, unfortunately. So strings, for example, cannot be mocked because string is a final class. Okay, you have to stop somewhere. Now the other way around. Now I know my code is calling the service correctly. Now I want to make sure that it's handling the return values. So I stub my service now. Stubbing works similar. I create my mock object. And now I specify my return values. So my data retrieve should return a 3 if called on keystring, and should return a 5 if called on other string. Done. Working object, giving my values. And now I can do my test. And since I'm testing double data at the moment, just making sure that it's working. Here as well, lots of things I can do, especially with that parameter in here. I can specify directly, like I did in my example. I can say no, everything but what I specified, no argument at all, exactly one argument, as many arguments as I like, one argument, but it must be a string. Or I can actually write a full-blown predicate in here. So the stub will only be used if that predicate evaluates to true. And since that's a closure, you can do all shenanigans in here that you can do in a closure. I can combine stubbing and mocking. So in this case, I expect 5 calls will be happening to this. And I have different variants to specify what I expect. Here I use the triple right shift and specify a list afterwards. This means first call will get the 1, second call will get the 2. So I can even specify for the same parameter different values to be returning. I can also specify a closure here. Closure will be evaluated and I get my return value out of the closure. And I can do everything in that closure that I want to be happening in a closure. Notice those backslashes. This is one line at the moment. So what this means is my first one will get a 1, my second will get a 2, the third one will get this one. My fourth one will get this one. This is, here I specify just an untyped args parameter for the closure, which then represents the argument list given to my call over here. And I can also do things like throwing exceptions in here. And now 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, if test has worked, those would be the 5 expected interactions with the mock. The last one, by the way, will be used over and over again if you have more interactions than you specified for. Okay, extensions. Spock can be extended pretty nicely. Extensions are available, say, whenever something gets, when a test starts, when a test is finished, specification is started. So lots of interfaces available to write your own stuff if you want to plug into the framework. This goes beyond this 101 talk. However, Spock is coming with several extensions built in already. The auto cleanup I showed previously is one of them. There are a couple more, like ignore. Ignore is, if something is not working at the moment, you can just put it on ignore so that it gets ignored and the rest of the stuff gets green again. I do not recommend checking in code with ignore statements in it, but for no, Andre, really not. But you can use it if you just have to go to lunch and want to make sure that all the others are working. A little bit more sensible, but also not recommended for check-in, is the ignore rest. This means all tests are ignored but the ones I flagged. So if I have a nice suite of 25 tests and I only want to, I'm working on 2 of them at the moment for refactoring purposes, I flag those 2, the other 23 will not be executed. Again, I would not check it in, but this one has its uses. Now, ignore if is something you are allowed to check in. Ignore if is a predicate to make sure a test is only executed sometimes. For example, don't execute my test on Windows because Windows can't handle what's happening in here. So this allows me to make it a little bit platform specific or other environmental factors. And there's also the positive version, which is called requires. Does the same thing, just in the positive notion. So that would be where the Windows test is going then. Then pending feature. Pending feature I like a lot. That is something for the test I'm currently working on. And if the test fails, it will just be ignored because it's under construction. The nice thing is, if the test succeeds, then I get an error. Because I'm working on it, it shouldn't be green. So flagging it with pending feature means I actually get a notification when I forgot to remove the pending feature. Stepwise. Evil. Sometimes necessary. Stepwise means that Spock must ensure the tests in my class are executed in the order they are written. Normally, I do not get a guarantee for that. They could be paralyzed or whatever. With stepwise, one will come after the other. So if you have a test where you must have test leakage, then that's the way to go to make sure that they're building on each other. Most cases where I'm actually using it is in interaction testing with UIs, where Selenium testings, where it's just too expensive to start from scratch every time. So there are some stepwise execution actually makes sense, but still evil. Timeout. With timeout, I can say, if this thing is not finished in 3 seconds, then give me a failure and continue. Confine meta class changes. In Scroovy, you can screw around with the meta class model of classes. Are you guys familiar with that? So think of it that you're going to the class and you're changing on the class level how the thing behaves. Pretty nice magic, actually. With that little annotation, I tell Spock that please undo all of my stuff I'm doing in a test after the test is executed. So since this, otherwise you have test leakage like crazy. Very helpful. Restore system properties, similar thing. You can, with this you tell Spock to remember what the system properties were before the execution. Then you can modify them as you want inside your test and see what happens, and afterwards it will be cleaned up again. And then there are a couple of built-in extensions for documentation purposes again, like title. With title you can give a natural language title to your to your test specification. Since the class name still has to conform to Java, to the Java language, it has camel case and everything. This is the way to get something nice and descriptive in front of it, as you can do for the methods. There's also a special field called narrative, which can be used to give a longer description of what this test is actually doing. With C, I can embed links to external references. For example, a special case would be issue, where I link it to my issue tracker system. And I also have subject to mark, by the way, this is what I'm actually testing in this whole suite, in this whole specification. So all of them are for documentation purposes. They have no actual logic behind them, but the reporting tools make use of them. So if you are building reports, then those are your friends. So, how can you make writing tests as fun and easy for yourself as possible? Well, use Spock, because it's all the automatic that you need. Thank you. Any questions? André, give him a mic. So Spock itself has no built-in way to differentiate tests. However, different other frameworks have it. So if you are, for example, using Grails, then Grails will separate between an integration test and a unit test by having different folders. And that way it's separated. But it's not built into Spock. Sure. Yeah, sure. If you, if you use the ignore or the requires in front of the specification, then you could flag the whole specification one way or the other. Then you just have to make sure that your test run uses the right parameter. Yeah, that would work.